Time Warner Audiobooks presents Harvest for Hope, written by Jane Goodall, with Gary McAvoy and Gail Hudson. Read by Tippi Hedren, with the introduction and conclusion read by Jane Goodall.
This is Jane Goodall. Why, people ask me, are you writing a book about food? I suppose it seems strange to those who do not know me. I am, after all, the chimpanzee lady. In Asia, I'm often called the chimpanzee mother. So why would I be interested in eating? Let me explain. I spent hours and hours from 1960 onward watching chimpanzees feeding. I collected specimens of what they were eating. I noted the behavior associated with eating. Keep everyone away if you possibly can, unless there's more than enough for everyone. Which means if you're the boss, you can keep everyone away from food that you really enjoy. I found over time that dominant females had a more successful reproductive career. They started having babies earlier, and they had more of them. So it was clear that high dominance rank helped you get more food and the best food, and that this would help your offspring, especially your daughters. Then they, like their mothers, would become high-ranking and successful. Food, therefore, was very important. And I found they would fight over food, especially a favored food in short supply. When I was not in the forest, I spent a lot of time people-watching. In the late 1960s, when I began giving lectures about chimpanzees, I was really terrified of public speaking. I often found myself at dinner parties that took place before I spoke. With my stomach in knots, there was no way I could eat. So I used to watch people. It helped calm my nervousness, because underneath the supposed civilized veneer of 20th century Homo sapiens, I could so easily see the same kind of behavior I had for so long watched in my chimpanzees. Then, in 1986, I attended a Chicago Academy of Sciences conference called Understanding Chimpanzees, and that changed my life. All those studying chimpanzee behavior in Africa, and many studying them in zoos, came together under one roof for a four-day conference. It became clear that these amazing apes were in trouble. Their habitat was vanishing. They were treated cruelly in many captive situations, and they were being eaten. They were being hunted and sold to make money. I found that this had become a serious problem, not only for chimpanzees, but for all forest animals. Because in addition to subsistence hunters, who have from time immemorial lived off the bounty of the forest, animals were now being hunted commercially. This was made possible by the new roads built by foreign timber companies, which provide access to previously inaccessible forests. Hunters rode the trucks, camped at the end of the roads, shot everything edible, from elephants to bats, smoked it, and sold it in town, where the urban elite paid more for this bush meat than for chicken or goat meat. I left the conference knowing that I had to do what I could to help save chimpanzees, improve their condition, pay back something of what they'd given me. I knew I could no longer sit and observe them in the forests I love. Instead, I had to travel the world, raising awareness of their plight, for they are on the brink of extinction. It was not long before I realized that the problems facing the chimpanzees are closely connected with the problems facing Africa, and I soon came to understand that in many cases, these problems could be laid directly at the door of the unsustainable lifestyle of the elite societies around the world. A lifestyle hatched in the Western world and exported, along with its values, or lack of them, and its technology, to the developing world. To help my chimpanzees, therefore, I had to start thinking about ways of opening the eyes of those who were unknowingly robbing the planet of more and more of her non-renewable natural resources. There are so many, many ways in which we are destroying the planet, and once we understand, once we care, then we have to do something. When I came to this realization, I knew I had a unique perspective. I had grown up in a time of austerity, during World War II, and learned to take nothing for granted. I learned that having enough of clothes and of food was what mattered. And I went from that happy childhood to the forests of Africa to study the chimpanzees and live my dream. When I first arrived in Gombe National Park in Tanzania, I found a world where all was pure. The springs that gave rise to the streams of Gombe were nurtured deep in the heart of an uncontaminated watershed. There were no man-made chemicals in the forest. Lake Tanganyika was the largest body of unpolluted fresh water in the world. And then, gradually, it all changed. The population living in the forests around Gombe multiplied. There were refugees from Burundi and from Congo. The trees were cut down. Soil erosion laid bare the once verdant mountain slopes. The people, peasant farmers and fishermen, the poorest of the poor, increasingly suffered. In their struggle to survive, they cut down the trees and the soil washed away. Many were hungry. Well-meaning foreigners interfered with the ancient fishing methods that had enabled the fishermen to live in harmony with their world, so that in the end, Lake Tanganyika was overfished. The people became increasingly poor, increasingly hungry. And I would leave Tanzania to lecture in Europe and America and see people eating, always eating. More and more food bought, more and more thrown away. People dying of eating too much, while the people of Africa, whom I had just left, were starving. I couldn't try to help only the chimpanzees when people were struggling to survive. So it became clear. To help the chimpanzees, it was necessary to work with the people living in the villages around Gombe. Gradually, I moved into different circles, where I began to learn more about poverty and hunger. As I traveled further and further around the world, I met more and more young people who had lost hope. I found despair, apathy, and anger, and I came to understand, listening to the voices of the wise, that humans are following a path that could easily lead to the end of life on Earth as we know it. For we are polluting with synthetic chemicals the air, the water, and the land. And a huge amount of that pollution is caused by the agricultural chemicals that are used as fertilizer, pesticide, and herbicide to grow our food. Chemicals that in some instances were developed for use in the war against human enemies. I found, too, that we are guilty of unbearable cruelty to the animals we raise as food. We have so far to go to realize our human potential for compassion, altruism, and love. It has become increasingly clear that growing, harvesting, selling, buying, preparing, and eating food plays a central role in the world. And it is equally clear that some things are going wrong. Much of our food is unhealthy. Many people are no longer aware of where their food comes from. Some have no idea what they are eating. In fact, over the past 100 years, especially during the half century since the end of World War II, the industrial technological world has increasingly destroyed our understanding of the food we eat, where it comes from, and how it reaches our tables. At one time, humans had a more intimate connection with the earth and the animals that sustained them. They collected their food, used primitive tools to crack open nuts, dismembered a carcass after a successful hunt, and, when they had found fire, gathered to eat in their rock shelter, probably with hyenas or wolves waiting for scraps outside. And then, with the coming of agriculture, people worked the fields, plowing and sowing and then harvesting. Everyone joined in, helping to bring in the grain and hay before it rained. And the women baked and boiled and fried the food and hung hams from the ceiling, and cows were milked, and butter and cheese was made in the dairy. The seasons were important, and the weather mattered because of how it affected the crops. Today there are more than 6 billion human beings on this planet, all needing to eat. And we have seen the rise to power of giant multinational corporations eager to exploit the opportunity of such a vast global market. In order to produce more and more food, either to feed hungry people or to satisfy the wants.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.